I can't really see you, so I'm going to sit here for 1 second and show you something. I used to be shit scared about talking in front of people. Really shit scared. Do you know the feeling? Yeah? You know what happened the other day? My son, so I'm going to share something really personal. My son came over and said, "Dad, do you get scared still?" I said, "Yeah, I do actually." And he had made this little thing for me. You know what it is? It's, "I have the guts to do it" thing. "Put this in your pocket," he said. He's 5 years old. "Put this in the pocket and then you'll find the courage to do it." So go with me. We find the courage, right? So yeah, thanks for the introduction. My job now is to turn knowledge into business. That's quite abstract, if you will. It's also a way to say that innovation is not this thing about flying cars and, you know, it's actually a way to make money. So if I look back, I'll give you a little review very soon. I think two things have driven me, plus one more. You know this insight that there are two things that decide your success in life. It's curiosity and persistence. Curiosity is about having the guts, right? That's why we need to make the decision that we want to conquer something. For me, it was to get in front of people and talk. Maybe you can find something else. And then persistence. And I realize I've been doing this for 10, 12, 13, 14 years. I think that's persistence, right? There's one more thing, which is believe in it. Just decide that you can do it. So when you leave today, what you want to take from my talk is a couple of notes, of course. Hopefully they inspire you and you can go home and you can change what you were doing before. But also leave with the feeling that it's possible. Really decide that you want to do it. If you want some help, I mean, there are tons of really smart people in the room. Go and talk to each other. Everybody likes to discuss. Everybody likes to learn from each other. That's how I learn. That's why I still do this, because then we can have a conversation. So by all means, please pull me aside. We grab a beer or something or tweet and we respond and we have a conversation, okay? Cool. So let's do this quickly because I only have 30 minutes. It's a little bit about me. A little bit about a company I started 10 years ago called The Milk. I include it because it's going to lead into what I'm going to talk about in modern measurement approaches or strategies, if you will. The Milk was based on the idea that it was not about technology. This was more than 10 years ago. We wanted to figure out how we could help companies sell more to consumers. And we realized it was not about what database or content management system or anything like that. It was about understanding what actually goes on, which became analytics, and why does it happen, which became consumer psychology and all these aspects of that, including, I guess, conversion rate optimization and UX and all that. That didn't really exist. Those terms hadn't been used 12 years ago. So for fun, I actually thought about just showing you a full deck from 10 years ago, because it's quite inspiring what was in it already. So I just grabbed 3 screenshots from it instead, just to set the story going. The first screenshot up, let's see if I have a pointer, up there, was a little model we made to say, at some point, marketing investments have such a bad marginal return, increased return on investment, that it's much better to spend the money on conversion rate optimization. I mean, that's a given now, but 10 years ago, no one had thought about it, right? Pretty obvious, you would think. And still, money was poured into marketing channels, TV, and with no measurability, no return on investment thinking, anything like that. So we made that little mock-up and said, you know, when the marginal return is too low, do something else instead and increase the total return. Which led to these discussions that we coined as what we called online space management. It was basically to say, offline, you can put the milk in the back of the store, more people will go all the way back to the end of the store, and it increases the value of a visit. Super basic today. No one had thought about doing that online 10 years ago. So it's about that ROI. Then we can expand from that. It led to all these discussions about attribution, about what is the correct customer journey understanding, etc., and I'll talk a little bit about it. It also led to this idea that maybe we should test. You know, content management systems were generating static pages 10 years ago. So we had this idea, we talked about it with some friends that were doing analytics at the time, and maybe some of you remember a little product that came out of those conversations. Anyone know what it was? Website Optimizer, exactly. Probably the first testing tool around. This screenshot is, I think, from 2006, something like that, yeah? That was the first time you could actually very easily and for free, run tests. Then it disappeared and it came back in different variations. But I mean, this is where all this comes from. So very long journey, cautious of time, I'll skip a lot of in-betweens, to say, where am I today? Today I'm running as innovation, a unit in a company that makes around 40 million. Super inspiring. We're not part of any special interests. We are Europe's biggest independent group. So we don't own any publishing channels. We can be totally neutral. And we actually built an acquisition. So the company I co-founded was down here, became part of Guava, that then joined the group, the Germans, Swiss, Switzerland, etc. Meta people. And then we made some more acquisitions. And last Monday, we announced that we made a very big acquisition of a French AI company, AI consultancy called Artifact, 100 people, data scientists that will join. So that gives me a lot more resources to play with machine learning and finding insights in data, which I'll also show you a little bit about. So are we all about data, or is the question I want you to put on your notepad and think about? Because we talk about metrics and dimensions and conversion rates and sessions and all that crap. Is it really about data? Or is it about performance? Whatever that means. And other people can bash conversion rates much better than I can. How do we define it? If we can't define it, we don't know what it is. So, I mean, we have these quotes, knowledge is power. It's a long time ago. Evan has said that data beats opinions, or someone else said it, but he's also used it. And I want to say knowledge beats data, right? So that's the point, right? This is not the point. It's the context. If we understand the context and we can turn the context into knowledge, then we can act on it. So what's changing? It's about now. It's about the fact that we can have data streams that come in real time and we can act on them. It's not about a report that looks back in time and we get it only once a month. Can we agree on that? Yeah? Thank you. I see a lot of nods. And even if they're in spreadsheets, we need a swear jar. Everybody that says spreadsheet needs to put money into it. Okay. It's actually about real time. Real time understanding and real time action. How do we do that? We do that with machine learning. It's the only thing that at scale can respond to signals, and I mean really at scale, at billions of hits scale. Machine learning is the answer. It's the only way. So what I'm going to show to you is another approach to analytics that will help you to do better machine learning on top of it. So one quick question. How many of you touch code and care about the quality of data? Reporting, analytics, tech management, etc.? I see a lot of hands. That's good. That's good. Very good. Then I talk to all of you, of course, but especially to you. So data is everywhere. That's an easy point to make. It's harder to achieve in reality. What do I mean by it? I mean, forget about a tag that runs in JavaScript in a browser or even something that goes into an app. It's much more than that. That's way too limited. And it's also super siloed. Because I sit down with a client and they will show me their four biggest channels and affiliate and email and what display maybe and search. And I add it up and it sums up to 200% of the actual business. Ridiculous, right? Why can't I deduplicate it, clean it up and understand how many actual business, how many people were there? I can't, because these are aggregated data sets. And they accept that they only get aggregated data sets back, and then we can't really figure out how many people were there. Total crap. And it's not put into a real context. So put it in a context by asking people. We've seen really good talks today about how you can do it. Get voice of consumer back. Try and understand where is this person in a journey that's much longer than 30 minutes or 30 days or something like that as a standard customer journey and attribution would be. There's a much bigger context. If I rent a car, is that part of a bigger vacation I'm trying to construct, for example? So there's so much more than these traditional digital channels of data sources. And this traditional idea that I could try and map out where people go and we forgot the physical world, and this is an old slide, so we still use the QR codes. Have anybody scanned a QR code recently? 1, 2, 3. I did one today, actually. That was to map WhatsApp to my Mac instance of WhatsApp. But other than that, I don't think it lives. Anyways, so the point is, data sits in the middle. The quality of data is horrendous, typically, and we need to do something about it. So here are two more challenges. To really understand the context, we need to have two more things. What people do when they're in a physical location, like, for example, in store, if you're retailers, or if you're an airline, maybe at your check-in kiosks or in the plane, that counts as in-store for me as well, or I think one of the biggest ones, in-home. What do we do at home? So I put in, and I mean the deck will be shared, I put in two YouTube links. In the first one up there, you can see a little Raspberry Pi. It's a video from a presentation I made last year where I scared the shit out of 800 C-level people in the fintech industry by showing them that with a Raspberry Pi, I could collect easily tracking data of how many people were in the room because I pick up the Wi-Fi ping from all the smartphones. Grab it with a Raspberry Pi and feed it into a live GA report. I don't know who you are. I just know how many people there are, so I can create a time series and correlate it with other things. Super easy. There's a whole industry exploding right now that will sell you that at very high prices. You can do it with a 20-euro computer and a little bit of code. And the bottom on the right side, obviously it's the Google Home, and it's there to represent all these conversational interfaces that are exploding right now. I don't know if you've played with them. They're total crap in many ways, but they will be very strong. So we built a little demo that shows how you can request an insurance quote from your home, talking to your Google Home device. And if you watched the I/O presentations a couple of weeks ago from Google, you saw that Google announced that they will support transactions and account creation on Assistant, which means in my home, I can actually ask for an insurance quote and accept it and pay for it directly. I showed that to another group of 500 C-level people in Amsterdam a couple of weeks ago, and they were really, really worried because it totally disrupts their industry and how that industry sells to people. So what's the message? Forget about traditional channels. Forget about paid media and all of that. Think about more data sets that can be part of the whole data set and use it to understand why people act as they do. So really quickly, here's a traditional customer journey, and I've just summarized 5 things that are wrong with that. And Jeff will do a talk after mine that will deep dive into that, the flaws of customer journeys. I just want to say, here are some ideas that you should go home and consider. What happened before these journeys started? Again, 30 minutes or 30 days or something like that. It's ridiculous. Right? For most brands that we consume, we've known those brands for years. I always use the example of walking into a hotel where I've stayed many times. They meet me with a blank face. I have a memory of having stayed there for the last 10 years maybe. You know, that's what the past means. I've worked with clients that have the ambition to have a 10-year journey. Understand what they showed to kids when they were 15 years old had this influence on their liking of the brand when they were 25. Why on earth accept sessions? That's where we get to modern measurement strategies. I'll deep dive in that. Sessions are ridiculous. Other people have bashed them for a while. I'll show you my response to that in a second. It's about humans. Why so much data missing? For obvious reasons, and I think I just gave 2 examples of where we can collect more data, in-home and in-store. And why are we still manually doing all these things about what the bid should be and the budget should be and the match type and the copy? Machine learning can do that. Oh. Sorry. It's alerting me that Jeff is going on the stage after me. Jump back in. Okay. You're still with me? Inspired? Few notes on the pad? Okay, I have a summary slide in the end if you didn't get any. Okay, final one. What's the actual value creation? I think it's ridiculously stupid to consider the value of a conversion just the one pair of shoes I buy. It represents an opportunity. And then if I ask you, most people will raise their hand and they'll say, yeah, so use a customer lifetime value instead. So instead I'll ask the question, what's wrong with customer lifetime value? Just a little side note to remind ourselves, what do we use this for? We use it to optimize all the media buying. But we also use it in our tests. If any of you do A/B testing, multivariate testing, this is the objective you're optimizing towards. This is how you consider success. And it's totally flawed. The minimum thing you should do is to weight the conversion with the value of the conversion and not just count conversions. And if you weight it with value, it's a little bit better. But that value represents something much bigger. What if you took the lifetime value and used it to predict the future chance that this person will consume more, and you annualized it and said, here's the annual opportunity that this person represents? Fairly easy to predict. And then use that as the objective. All your tests will get different results. Now I scared you. Now you're silent. This is getting fun. Okay, so move on. Why should we accept only aggregated data? We shouldn't. We need to go beyond also. We cannot accept predefined metrics and dimensions because they are totally ridiculous. They're fine for a daily report, but in the bigger picture, they're useless. Sessions, I already bashed them. Forget sessions. Understanding users is at the core. So that was what I meant when I said context. This doesn't work anymore. And I'll skip all this, you can read it later. All these challenges about how you actually define the data set and you decide the weight in your journey and all that, forget it. It doesn't really give you the answer. So this is not good enough, this is not good enough. This is the fun part. What happens next? A, cookies will die. If you've seen the news in the last few weeks, Mozilla, I think Safari, Chrome, they will all start to block cookies, right? What does that mean? That means that the basis of all these customer journeys and a lot of the testing we do that is based on return visitor capturing via cookies will face a huge problem because there will be no cookies. If you come up after and ask me, I will give you the answer to the question, what replaces it? It's also there. It's called device graphs. Okay, we're halfway. You're still awake? Good. Okay, so what to do about it? I always argue that here's one example of a platform that you can consider. There are many other platforms, and you can swap pieces of this with other tools, obviously. You can stitch a platform together, if you will. You can stitch solutions. I've been sitting with clients that have parts of this and then have other parts. That just makes it a little bit more complicated, but here's a bigger context. There are four pieces, right? The analytics stack with testing, all the data that comes in from the advertising and other channels than Google, of course. The double-click stack, the world's most used ad server. That's not the point. The point is down there in the left bottom. Cloud. Cloud computing. Cloud computing changes this whole conversation. So I'll pick a few examples of what can be done, and then I'll show you if my browser will let me. If you send me some good energy, I'll show you some live example. Okay, so I don't know if you know, but there's a tool called BigQuery. BigQuery is a database that can scale to handle very large data sets. Any of you play with BigQuery? One, two, three. That gives the rest of you a big to-do on your notepad. Go home, put BigQuery. You can get free use of it up to quite a big, substantial amount of data and play with it. Why? Because all Google's channels, it's been announced, will have the ability to export data out to BigQuery. YouTube, for example. Then, another tool called Cloud Pops Up is a tool that allows us to take these streams of data that come in from data sources and decide where we want to send them at scale. This is what powers, I think, something like Spotify. It's what powers things like Uber, etc. Then we have Cloud Data Flow that allows us also to manipulate data. And what do we use it for? So, quick jump into real world. What's the point of this? The point of this is to say, don't accept your analytics data as it is. Think outside the box and think, if you have a better data set, granular data set, then you can do so much more. So, I'm just going to jump over here and say, let's assume that you're running Google Analytics, and we could hijack the hit, all the data that Analytics collects and pushes into GA. What if we could put that data into a big repository where it didn't get aggregated, where it didn't throw away all the details, and didn't give you sampling and all that? So here's a dashboard, and I'm not going to explain in detail all the pieces. They're in the slides as backup, so if you get the deck, you can see what we do. But just super quickly, an example. If I load the web page, I get cookied from GA. The cookie ID is down here, very easy to find here, GID. You can see here. I get an ID in the cookie. The point is, by manipulating Tag Manager, we're sending a hit also to a cloud endpoint that we created. The cloud endpoint then feeds it through PubSub and Dataflow into BigQuery at full granularity. So if I go over here in BigQuery and I search for my cookie ID here, simple SQL, I'm selecting the table, I'm searching for the ID of the cookie, I can see that my hit was there. I meant to do it in real time, but cautious of time. I cooked it up already, but believe me, there's a whole table of all the hits and I just search for the one that came from my cookie. And when it's in BigQuery, we can use it for a lot of things. For example, I could visualize it, Data Studio. I don't have time, but if I clicked edit, I could, I don't know if you've played with Data Studio, I could easily create a time series, you know, expose some more data, etc., etc. So what did I just show you in summary? I showed you a pipeline that looks like this. We're taking data from analytics, we're feeding it in via PubSub, Cloud Dataflow, and we store it in BigQuery. You get the point why it's smart. I'm avoiding all the aggregation. I'm avoiding all the forced sampling of the data. I get the raw flow of data in real time at pretty much any scale, whatever size of traffic you have, I can take it, and then I can start to play with it. So if you haven't done it, I really recommend go down and download Trifacta. There's a free version. And then take the BigQuery data and import it into Trifacta and start playing with it. It applies machine learning on the data so that it advises you what you should be looking for in your data. It's basically an assistant that helps you deep dive into your data set. Fantastic. It's not making analysts out of a job, it's making analysts better. And TensorFlow obviously is a machine learning library, so you could train a model. You can then expose your model over in Cloud ML over there and use it to do predictions at scale in real time. Data Studio, or put it in Dataproc or Cloud Data Lab. So here are the steps. I'm going to skip them because you can read it offline later. So the response to what do we use it for in my day job? We use it to take all the data that comes in from all these channels. We challenge the quality of it. We improve the quality tremendously by doing this little hack. And now I just use Google Analytics. It can be any data source. It can be your point of sale system. It can be a beacon. It can pretty much be whatever. Measurement protocol from analytics is fantastic for capturing hits. And then we crunch it and we figure out what to do with it. You can even push it in as new metrics if you wanted to push it back into analytics. There's some good studies that show how you can use it to classify the value of consumers, for example. So your sessions actually have a custom dimension with a label that says this is a high engaged consumer, this is a high value consumer, for example. Or propensity to be loyal is one of the ones I like to do. Here's an example from Petri over in Finland. He scored users on the engagement, pulling the data out, running the model on it, and then pushing it back in. We do the same. Take all the silos, deduplicate it, crunch it, and figure out in the end how many unique people are we looking at, and what did they do. In this raw data set, I can keep the data for 10 years if I want. And I can take all the hits I had from that person over 10 years across channels and work on that. So here's the summary I use for facilitating a discussion when I sit with a client. Just topics for discussion. In the end, the time is always now, as they say in Amsterdam. Collect raw data, synchronize it, deduplicate if you will, wrangle it, that term comes from Trifacta, analyze it and use it to predict. That helps you gain the knowledge that you can use to advise or drive more business or whatever your context is. That's what I said in the beginning. It's not about data, it's about knowledge. Thank you.